Thanks to Brilliant.org for supporting PBS Digital Studios. When you look in a mirror, you might think you see a perfect reflection, but you're actually looking at a universe whose laws are fundamentally different. When we think about symmetry, the first thing that comes to mind is mirror symmetry. Butterflies, Rorschach tests, and classically attractive faces all look the same when flipped left to right. In physics, asymmetry is when the laws of physics are unchanged due to some transformation of coordinates. We've seen examples where this holds. The universe is symmetric to coordinate shifts in space, time, and even the rather abstract phase of the wave function in quantum mechanics. So it might be surprising to learn that with all the weird ways in which the universe is symmetric, it's not entirely symmetric under the most intuitive one. The laws of physics work differently in the universe of the mirror. Let's talk about the physics of entering the mirror universe. The technical name for such a reflection is a parity transformation. And when something remains identical under such a transformation, we say that the thing is parity symmetric, p-symmetric. Parity is a weird type of symmetry. In the case of those other symmetries I mentioned, the shift in position, time, or phase can be by any amount, small or large. These are continuous symmetries. But there's no such thing as a partial reflection. You either reflect or you don't. Parity is a discrete symmetry. Other types of discrete symmetries include charge conjugation, flipping the sign of the electric charge, and time reversal, sending the clock ticking backwards. We'll come back to both of these. They are going to save us in the end. Parity transformations involve the flipping of spatial axes. If we define the mirror to be in the XY plane, reflections send Z to minus Z and vice versa. Objects are turned back to front and front to back. And it looks like your right hand becomes your left and vice versa, as though you'd actually flipped in the X direction, not the Z. Well, actually, a true X-axis reflection would look like this. Left still goes to right, but forward facing stays the same. This is exactly the same as a Z-axis reflection plus a rotation. In fact, a reflection on any single axis can be reproduced by a reflection on a different axis plus a rotation. A reflection on two axes then puts things back to normal, while reflection on all three axes gives the same left-right switch as a reflection on one axis. But formally, a full parity inversion means flipping all three axes. Now, when you reflect the universe, obviously it is different. All position vectors point in the opposite direction, same with velocity slash momentum. Throw a ball at the mirror away from yourself, and its reflection looks like it's coming towards you. In the language of parity, we call properties that flip sign odd functions. Properties that don't change under reflections are called even. Things like the energy of the ball, its mass, the time on its clock, and, as we'll see, angular momentum don't change in the mirror universe. Now, even though some signs do get flipped, the laws of physics should be unaltered in that mirror world. Newton's laws will still give the ball's trajectory. Those laws work the same, no matter the direction of motion. In fact, if we rotate the whole mirror ball's trajectory by 180 degrees, it's identical to the original trajectory. But that's only true if the ball itself is unchanged in the reflection. But what if we try something else? Let's put some spin on the ball, say clockwise spin. The reflected ball is still spinning clockwise. Its angular momentum is unchanged. But the relationship between the ball's angular momentum and its regular momentum, the direction of motion, is flipped. This is similar to the switching of left and right hands in a mirror reflection of a person. In fact, we talk about the direction of spin as handedness. You can grab the ball with your fingers pointing in the direction of its spin and your thumb pointing in the direction of motion. If you need to use your right hand to do that, then the spin is right-handed relative to the motion. That's the case of the unreflected ball in our example. If you need to use your left hand, as in the case of the reflected ball, then the spin is left-handed relative to motion. The handedness of a moving spinning object is called its helicity. A spot on its surface draws a helix that spirals either one way or the other. But the general term for handedness is chirality. A chiral object is one that is fundamentally changed by reflection. Parity transformations flip from left-handed to right-handed chirality. Hands have left or right chirality, so do spinning flying balls, so do many molecules, and some quantum particles. But chirality in quantum mechanics means something quite specific. Quantum chirality is connected to quantum spin, but for any particle with mass, motion doesn't factor into it. It's not the same as helicity. It's best to think of quantum chirality as a fundamental internal right or left-handed asymmetry. And most chiral particles have both right and left-handed versions. Do these versions behave differently? Well, you wouldn't think so, would you? Why should the universe treat righties and lefties differently? In fact, it was assumed for the longest time that the universe did conserve parity. And it appeared to be the case in experiments, at least for tests involving gravity, electromagnetism, and the strong nuclear forces. It was assumed that the weak nuclear force was the same deal. That's until the tau-theta problem came along. Tau and theta were a pair of particles, two quark mesons to be precise, that looked the same in all respects. Same spin, same mass, same electric charge, but different decay products. The tau decayed into three pions, also mesons, while the theta decayed into two pions. That was the only difference between them, so couldn't a single particle have two decay outcomes? Well, yeah, but the problem is that those two decay outcomes have different parity. The combination of two pions has even parity, while the combination of three pions has odd parity. A single particle should produce decay products with the same parity, so the same response to reflections. That's what we mean by conservation of parity. At least one of these decay products broke conservation of parity. Violation of parity conservation was the solution to the tau theta problem suggested by Yi and Lang in 1956, and for which they later won the Nobel Prize. They proposed that tau and theta are the same particle, which turns out to be the kaon, and that the weak interaction which governs this decay does not conserve parity. But how to test this? Yi and Lang found a brilliant experimentalist to test their hypothesis. The her being Qianxiong Wu, who for some reason didn't get in on that Nobel Prize. In 1957, Wu conducted an experiment based on a simple argument. If parity is conserved, then there should be no experiment you can do to determine whether you live in the regular universe or a mirror universe. That means that left-handed and right-handed particles should decay in the same way. Wu tested this using the cobalt-60 atom. The nucleus of this radioactive isotope of cobalt decays via the weak interaction into nickel by emitting an electron and some gamma-ray photons and neutrinos. The cobalt-60 nucleus also happens to have an unusually high spin, which means it's possible to align the spin of the nucleus using a magnetic field. So, Wu and team applied a magnetic field to a layer of cobalt-60 and watched them decay. They found that almost all of the electrons produced in the decay emerged in the opposite direction to the nuclear spin axis. That right there was the smoking gun of parity violation. Let's see why. The important thing is that the momentum of the ejected electrons had any correlation with the spin of the nucleus at all. Why? Well, let's look at how both momentum and spin are affected by parity transformations. To do this properly, we need to reflect the cobalt nucleus in all three directions: left, right, forward, back, up, down. You can see that the spin of the nucleus, which we represent with the angular momentum vector along the axis, is not changed. It's still spinning in the same direction, so the axis of that spin still points up. But the same transformation on the electron's momentum vector leaves it pointing in the opposite direction. So, if there is any relationship between the direction that electrons are ejected and the spin of the nucleus, then that relationship must flip in a mirror universe. But that gives us an easy test to see which handed universe we live in. Ergo, parity symmetry is violated. In fact, the only way for parity to be conserved is if there is absolutely no correlation between spin direction and the direction of the emitted electrons. That way, nothing would change in the reflection. But that's not what the experiment showed. So how does the spin of the cobalt nucleus relate to all of this chirality stuff? Well, you can define the handedness by the relationship between the direction of the electron and the direction of the spin axis. That's not the same handedness as the quantum chirality of all the quarks comprising that nucleus. But it's probably connected. Parity transformation flips the handedness of those quarks, and apparently parity transformation must affect the direction of the decay electrons also. In fact, we know that there is parity violation at the level of quantum chirality. It may be the ultimate source of the different rules in the mirror universe. Why? Because the carriers of the weak interaction, the W and Z bosons, only interact with left chiral particles. They completely ignore right-handed particles. The universe of the mirror really does behave in a fundamentally different way to our universe. This realization has vexed physicists ever since Wu's experiment. The resolution to this broken symmetry could be in a greater symmetry. See, parity is intrinsically connected to the symmetries of electric charge and the direction of time. Just as a reflection in two directions will get you back to where you started, a parity transformation followed by a flipping of electric charge, positive to negative and vice versa, and a reversal in the direction of the flow of time will also restore a system to its original state. This is CPT symmetry, and so far it appears to hold in all experiments. We'll come back to our ongoing quest to discover whether CPT is the true underlying symmetry of the universe, deeper than the broken symmetry of parity in a mirror-reflected space-time. Whether it's classical mechanics or quantum mechanics, learning the ins and outs of physics is tough. Thankfully, there are online tools that can help, like Brilliant, a problem-solving website that teaches you to tackle difficult topics and think like a scientist by breaking up complexities into understandable pieces. And instead of just passively listening to lectures, you get to master concepts by solving interesting and challenging problems. So whether you want to learn about special relativity, quantum physics, or brush up on your complex algebra and differential equations, you can learn more at brilliant.org/spacetime. Before we get to comments, just a reminder, you can support Spacetime by checking out our new merch store, link in the description, or just visit us on Patreon. Now, last time we talked about a wild notion for how life may have originated on Earth. Perhaps it came from space. Let's hear what you had to say about the panspermia hypothesis. Scorch428 points out the problem with panspermia is that it doesn't solve the problem of the initial origin of life, the first abiogenesis. Yeah, it doesn't. What it does do is open the possibility that that origin was extremely improbable. If it only had to happen once in the galaxy, then we can consider abiogenesis mechanisms that are tens of billions of times less probable than mechanisms that could have got life started from scratch on Earth. Because we know that if life really started on Earth, then it started fast. If it started somewhere else, then the chemical steps to the first true cell could have taken billions of years, wherever that happened. Anyway, I don't want to particularly favour panspermia over Earth-based abiogenesis, but I do want to be clear about what the hypothesis offers. Penny Lane and Derek Curry suggest that if panspermia is right, then early Earth life should have been more complex. Well, not necessarily. The most simple cells do seem to have the most capacity for surviving in space. Bacterial and fungal spores, for example, can shrivel down and stabilize their DNA for very, very long periods of time. The more complex the organism, the more difficult it is to go into this sort of hibernation. Even tardigrades can't survive for many millennia, or even the millions of years that spores may be able to. Estelle Leah proposes that we become aliens who originate life across the galaxy by sending light-sail probes carrying super-resistant life forms. Well, maybe let's get our atmosphere-sniffing telescopes up and running to see what's already out there first. But your proposal does raise a notion. We're within a generation of being able to do this ourselves with the sort of technology being developed for the Breakthrough Starshot program. So surely alien civilizations with any sort of technological lead on us would have tried it. In fact, this has been proposed as an origin for life on Earth. It's called directed panspermia. It gets around a lot of the problems with natural panspermia because presumably organisms could be carefully selected or even genetically modified and protected for such a journey. More importantly, the capsules or whatever containing these seeds could be at least somewhat targeted to star systems or even planets. Depending on assumptions, evolving a technological civilization to the point that they can initiate a directed panspermia program gives you much better numbers than randomly scattering lithophilic bacteria from asteroid impacts with a non-technological planet. Even if non-tech planets are vastly more abundant. Anyway, I feel like I'm straying into subjects that Isaac Arthur would do better. Come to think of it, he probably has done better. And speaking of awesomely speculative ideas, Samuel Long very rightly complains about our failure to mention Fred Hoyle or Chandra Wickramasinghe, who are among the earliest proponents of panspermia. Besides starting the modern interest in the idea, they also had some really cool fringe notions, like that epidemics and evolutionary leaps might be due to microbes arriving from space. In fact, this stuff was all in our panspermia script at one point, but we decided to be less historical and more current. Anyway, props to Hoyle. No one ever said Hoyle was afraid of pursuing fringe ideas. Even that new dark energy, dark matter is a negative mass fluid thing references him heavily. And yeah, we'll be covering that. After we do, why string theory is wrong. Because you guys haven't stopped complaining that it isn't up yet. It'll be up next week. I hope you aren't too disappointed if it turns out that string theory is right. I feel like you're all lining up to watch an execution here.